Hey, Mike.
I know you got a lot of problems downtown, but I've got a couple of problems at the house I wish you could take care of.
One, I've got some cats parking in front of the house. I can't get down to the office, and that garbage truck next to the office has got to be moved.
So what I need is a red zone. It's a simple thing you can take care of.
Honey, would you come here a minute, please?
Do it.
Are you okay?
Everything's fine. Yeah, fine.
Listen, if the kids go on board and it's worrying you.
No.
And they can play out here on the beach.
All right, let them go.
It's cold. We know all about you, Chief. You don't go in the water at all, do you?
Some bad hat, Harry.
Chief Brody, you are uptight.
Yes.
Come on. That's it.
Thus, the dangers of the great white shark are made real to the fictional residents of Amity Island in this 1975 blockbuster. Who guessed 70s? Anybody? 1975 blockbuster named Jaws, which actually won 3 Academy Awards and in 2001 was selected for inclusion in the United States National Film Registry for being culturally, historically, or aesthetically significant. Now, Jaws is the final entry in our At the Movies series. And this series was created to give all of us together a new perspective in how we view the world around us, to learn how to see God's hand in all things, even in areas we might not expect, like the media. But we see that God is present. It simply has to become our priority, as in all things, to find him. Now, for those of us who might be unfamiliar with the plot line of Jaws, I will catch you up just a little bit as we dig into today's message. So this movie follows a beachside tourist community whose idyllic summer is turned upside down when the sheriff, Martin Brody, the one of the actors we just saw in this clip, discovers early on that a young woman has been killed by a shark. He tries to close the beaches down, but is met with resistance from the mayor and local business owners who rely on summer income to keep their businesses going. So reluctantly, Brody allows the beaches to remain open. And he is horrified when a young boy in this scene we just watched together becomes the next victim of the shark. So the boy's mother puts a bounty on the shark, and the island is soon overrun with amateur hunters and fishermen who are trying to cash in on that cash reward. So what Brody does is he convinces the mayor to contract with a local fisherman named Quint who has experience hunting sharks. So soon, as the movie progresses, Brody, Quint, and Matt Hooper from the Ocean Institute find themselves on Quint's boat on their way to capture this shark. Now, to be honest, Jaws is not necessarily my standard genre of chosen movie. As we were rewatching this yesterday with the family for a little refresher, I made the comment as they're chasing the shark, it's like, wow, it is taking them a really long time to get this shark. To which my 16-year-old son, he looks over me and he goes, what? Mom, you watch British period dramas. All they do is go to each other's houses and eat a lot. He has a point. However, that's actually quite scintillating. If you haven't tried it, just give it a try. You'll love it. But it does take the three main characters a little while to catch this great white shark. Now, as they do, Jaws does have one scene that does truly resonate. And it takes place after Brody, Quint, and Matt are on the boat. And after baiting the shark, they see it for the first time. They see its sheer size and are overwhelmed by how large this shark truly is. Now, once they see the shark, Brody delivers one of the movie's most iconic lines. Does anybody know what it might be? Exactly. You're gonna need a bigger boat. And it's from this scene that we take our title for today's message today. We're gonna need a bigger boat, increasing our capacity for the kingdom. But before we jump into that, let's actually watch this scene together.
You heard him, slow ahead. Slow ahead. I can go. Shut off that engine.
Shout out to our amazing media team for the awesome edit on that. They did a good job. So we're gonna need a bigger boat. You, me, every single one of us. If we are going to fully experience what God has in store for each of us, what God has planned for each of us, what God wants to do in us and through us, we are going to need a bigger boat. Like Brody, Matt, and Quint, the sheer enormity of it all is simply not going to fit in the vessel in which we currently operate. We often live in these little self-contained bubbles of me, right? This is where I am. This is what I can do. This is where my limits are. And these are very well defined. We define them for ourselves. And we can spend a lot of time very carefully structuring this really beautiful system of can do and cannot do. And this is the world in which we tend to operate. But the problem with this system that we've all created, as neat and tidy as it is that it tends to create this lovely border around ourselves that is almost impenetrable. The border is as far as I go. If I step out of my comfort zone, I only stepped this far. There's a border right there. That's as far as we go, right? Have we experienced that? But the question is, what are we missing in all of that comfort? Now, I was thinking as I was preparing and praying over this message today, when I was a little girl, I was painfully, painfully shy. Never in a million years, if you knew me as that little girl, would you have ever thought that you would see me here today? And it was, I couldn't talk to people. Like, I would just kind of shrivel into this little ball of me to even say hello to anyone. And that followed me through my childhood and through my teen years and even into my adulthood, even after we were married. I would get this like heart palpitations. I would get so nervous, so scared if we ever went to talk to anyone outside of those people that were in my safe little circle, my bubble. And I began to look at relationships outside of that circle and relationships outside of that circle. And I watched people interact and laugh and share life and share experiences and just simply share conversation. And I desperately longed to be a part of those type of experiences. And they seem so simple. Everyone else just walks up and talks. I don't understand, Lord, why I can't just walk up to someone and say hello. I couldn't put my finger on what it was, but there was just this invisible wall that I could not push past. And so I began to pray, Lord, make me brave. I know it seems like a silly thing to ask for bravery for, but for me it was all too real. Lord, give me the courage to say hello. Give me the courage to have a conversation, to share experiences, to talk about hopes and dreams. What I was praying was, without realizing it, was, Lord, as you give me courage, remove the borders that I've built around myself. I began, as I prayed and as the Lord began to grow courage in me, I decided to challenge myself because I'm all about the challenges. I mean, if you don't want me to do something, challenge me to something and I will do it. My husband and I have been married 23 years yesterday, actually, side note. And he and I will actually often joke about that. He's like, if there's something that I really would love my wife to do, I just tell her, no, Teffonie, I don't think you should do that. And then guess what? I'm like, oh, guess what I'm doing, right? It works well in our marriage. But so I began to challenge myself. Okay, Lord, I'm going to talk to someone new every day. Lord, I'm going to push through my borders. It was as simple as just someone I met in a grocery store. The cashiers, I was buying our groceries. I'm going to push myself, Lord. I'm going to be courageous and say hello. And what I didn't realize is I continued to step out of this little box that was comfortable that I'd created for myself in doing, my borders enlarged and my capacity increased. I think the question we have to ask ourselves is, as we're safe in this comfortable little box, what lies beyond our borders of self? Is it increased influence? Increased generosity? Increased patience? Increased love? Increased wisdom? All of the above, and so much more. And why would we want to stay in this little bordered box that we've created ourselves, as beautiful and comfortable as it is, when we can see through that wall and we can see on the other side that which is greater than what we're experiencing right now? In a nutshell, we can see increased capacity. Brian Houston. He's the pastor of Hillsong Church. And he wrote, "To see our dreams fulfilled and to continue having influence in God's kingdom, our capacity must increase." We have to go past what we see as our limit. Now, often we think of capacity as output, and I've sort of described it in that way up to this point. But let's also think about it as input as well, because we must increase our capacity to receive God's biggest miracles, to stop limiting what God can do in our lives with where we feel comfortable or at what point maxes us out. Because see, the hard thing about a wall is why it can keep us here and protect us. It can also keep the blessings, the purpose, the promise, the victory, the hope, the peace, the restoration. It also keep that on the other side of that wall as well. It's a two-way street. And so as we're thinking about increasing our capacity, as we're thinking about, okay, Lord, what are you putting inside of me, Lord, to step out of my comfort zone and to step into with confidence? At the same time, Lord, as I'm breaking open that shell, as I'm bursting open those borders, what blessings and promises and miracles are you preparing to pour out now that I'm here and I can just say, yes, Lord, I receive? It goes both ways. To go back to the story I shared just a moment ago about myself, I learned through that process that I received so much more than I ever put forth. Because what I also learned in that process, that I was limiting my view of who God said that I am. I was telling myself that I was shy, that I couldn't talk to people, rather than saying, Lord, how do you see me? Who do you see me? Who did you create me to be? Now, I'm not going to say that it's not still easy all the time. There's not times when I see that box and I think, oh, that box was really comfortable. I knew that box. Maybe I should step back into those box and those borders. That's not to say that never happens, because it does. I do continue to pray, Lord, give me courage. Challenge me to step out, to speak with confidence, and to see myself as who you see me to be. But I can tell you now, on this side of that particular box in my life, on this side of the increased capacity in my life, it is nothing like I ever imagined. It is nothing like I could have ever envisioned the conversations and the life and the love and the laughter that I've been able to experience outside of that comfortable space. And that's what we're talking about with increasing our capacity, because that's the biggest gift. When that capacity increases, we begin to see ourselves as God sees us. Now, I do think that we can forget that God does not look at us with the same lens that we look at ourselves. Because we get so comfortable. We look in the mirror and we get comfortable. I get comfortable with how I see myself, how I perceive myself. And okay, this is who I am. This is how I see myself. And I can forget God does not look through that same mirror. God is not looking through that same lens. God does not see someone who is just getting by. God does not see someone who is just making it work. Rather, he sees the richness and the fullness of who he created each of us to be. As my husband shared last week about the spiritual glasses, the Lord looks through that lens. And I can just imagine him saying, as he's looking down, you and I, his kids, and he's saying, come on, you can do this. See yourself as I see you. You can do this. Because you know, Jesus, he's our biggest champion. You can do this. So how do we increase capacity? Let's take just a couple of minutes and look at five key aspects. We're going to look at a story out of Luke. I am going to read it out of my notes. My Bible is NLT, but today I'm going to read it out of the Message version. And it's a story about some men, like Brody and Quint. They also needed a bigger boat. We'll pick this story up very early in the start of Jesus' ministry, when Jesus has begun preaching and teaching. He has met Simon, who we later know to be Peter, one of the apostles, and he has met him earlier through healing Simon's mother-in-law when Jesus was at Simon's house. And now, not too much later, we pick up our story right here. And here's where we're going to get our five key points to increasing capacity. So Luke 5, and I'm going to read it out of the Message. Once when he, and that's Jesus, was standing on the shore of Lake Gennesaret, the crowd was pushing in on him to better hear the word of God. He noticed two boats tied up. The fishermen had just left them and were out scrubbing their nets. He climbed into the boat that was Simon's and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Sitting there, using the boat for a pulpit, he taught the crowd. Let's stop here for just a minute, because this is our first key to increasing our capacity. And that's number one, which Simon demonstrates, and that is flexibility. You heard, blessed are the flexible, for they shall not break. So Simon, in the scripture, he had literally just come back from the sea that we read. He was cleaning his nets. He probably, if we think through this story and what's happening, had his boat tethered, packed up, and everything put back away and in its place, ready for him to go home, to rest, and then go back out the next morning. But now Jesus walks up and basically says, hey, Simon, let's undo all of that hard work that you just did. Let's get the boat back out and let's go back out on the water. And I actually love Simon's response here, because it's actually no response at all. Because we learn more from what Simon did not say than what he could have said. Because we read in scripture, as we read, the very next sentence, Jesus is teaching from the boat. Simon probably thought, okay, well, I just put the boat away, but sure, we can go back out again. Absolutely. Let me just untie this and untether this and hop on in and here we go. Without Simon even realizing it, his borders of self were being enlarged by simply saying yes. And that's the first piece. Let's keep reading. Verse 4. When he, and that's Jesus, finished teaching, Jesus said to Simon, push out into deep water and let your nets out for a catch. Simon said, Master, we've been fishing hard all night and haven't caught even a minnow. But if you say so, there's that yes again, I'll let out the nets. It was no sooner said than done. A huge haul of fish straining the nets past capacity. And that's our second piece to hold on to, as we're stepping out of our comfort zone and enlarging our territory. And that is certainty in who Jesus is. It's trust. Hey, Jesus, okay, it didn't work earlier when we were out fishing, but okay, because you said so, because you said try again, then I will. Why, Jesus? Because I trust you. Because I know from your word over and over and over again, those 6,000 promises that are in your word, that if you said you will do it, you will. And so, Jesus, I'm stepping with certainty out of this fear. I'm stepping with courage out of this fear, Lord, because you said yes, and I trust you. Let's continue reading. From there, they, that's Simon, they waved to their partners in the other boat to come help them. They both filled boats, nearly swamping them with the catch. So earlier today, we couldn't get a single thing, and now we have two boats filled to overflowing with the catch. What do we learn from that? The third piece in enlarging our territory is accountability. It's teamwork. We need friends. We need a team. We need people around us who will champion us as we grow our borders. People who will partner with us, who will stand alongside of us and say, you've got this, you can do this. people who will, yes, hold us accountable with grace when we start to slip, or when that wall looks a little too firm to step through, or the comfort starts feeling a little too nice. People we trust who are men and women of God who will say, oh no, because I love you, I'm not gonna let you stay where you are. I'm gonna encourage you to take another step. And you know, we get the opportunity to be those people as well, to be the team, to be the cheerleaders, to be the champions for the people around us, and to say, you got this. God said, yes, let's step with courage. Find those people. If you can't think of those people in your life right here, today, in this room, this is a great place to start. Grab somebody and say, hey, you want to be on my team? I guarantee you, we're all going to say, yes, I would love to be on your team. Let's keep reading. We're at verse 8 now. Simon Peter, when he saw it, that net full, he fell to his knees before Jesus. And what did he say? He said, Master, leave. I'm a sinner and can't handle this holiness. Leave me to myself. When they pulled in that catch of fish, awe overwhelmed Simon and everyone with him. It was the same with James and John, Zebedee's sons, who were co-workers with Simon. That's number 4. We walk in repentance and in awe of who our Jesus is. We take that moment to say, Lord Jesus, I was getting pretty comfortable in my borders. I was getting pretty comfortable where I was. But Lord Jesus, I ask for your forgiveness. I don't want to stay the way I am, where I am, any longer. Lord Jesus, forgive me for not trusting you, for not believing that you had every step planned and prepared and purposed for my good. And as we repent, it brings a sense of awe, just like Simon and the boys, as they were in awe of this catch that couldn't even be contained by these two boats. Further lessening of self and that increase from Jesus in a way that only he can show, can provide, and can prepare. And finally, verse 10, Jesus said to Simon, there is nothing to fear. From now on, you'll be fishing for men and women. They pulled their boats up on the beach, left them, nets and all, and followed him. And that's number 5. One of my favorites. I love them all, but this one definitely speaks to my heart. And that's ingenuity. Be ready to expect the unexpected. Be ready to experience what is outside that box. We know the expression, think outside the box. Oh, just wait till God starts thinking outside the box for your life. It gets really exciting and really wonderful really fast. We know in the end of Jaws, I hope it's not a spoiler. You've had about 25 years to catch up, so I'm going to go, we're okay. No, more than that. My math is off. Okay. Brody and Matt do defeat the shark. And we know from watching the movie, it is not any way in the way that they planned. But it does work, right? I'm not gonna tell you how. So if you haven't seen Jaws, run home and watch Jaws today. But it does work, and it's ingenious. I love it. I love what they come up with in the end of the movie. And I love it because it's so much like our Jesus. The way he works everything out, not in the way we thought he would or possibly even suggested, in our prayers, but in the very best way possible. And we know from Scripture, for Simon, James, and John, that they continued to fish, but not like they had before. They continued to fish for the kingdom. And we know that ultimately, that is the best possible outcome. Enlarging our borders. It doesn't happen without some grunts, without some groans, without some growing pains. But it is so worth it. So worth it to see how Jesus sees us instead of how we see ourselves. So worth it to step outside of that box that's hemming us in and not only walk with confidence into the future that God has spoken over us, but also to receive over and over and over again the miracle of who He is and how He works in each of our lives. To be flexible. To have certainty, to have trust in who Jesus is. To live in accountability. To seek repentance and awe of Jesus Christ. And yes, to think, to worship, to praise, to love with ingenuity, to expect the unexpected, because we know that whatever we can imagine, God's going to blow it right out of the water. As we close tonight, today, this morning, I'd love to pray with you. Love to pray that God enlarges your capacity, that He increases your borders, that you push past your limits, and that you experience with certainty, with awe, with just expectation and joy, the fullness of God's dreams, God's plans, and God's purposes for your life. Would you bow your heads with me as we pray together, as we close? And if God is just whispering in your spirit, if He's whispering, now is the time. Step out of the comfort. Push past your limits. Push past the box. Look at yourself the way I see you. Walk with confidence. If that's you, if He's whispering into your spirit, just lift your hand to Him. Just lift your heart to Him. No one's looking around. Every eye is closed. This is just between you and our Jesus. Let's, as my husband said earlier, let's just sometimes that physical act of simply raising our hand and saying, yes, Lord, it's me. He knows. He already knows. But for us to make that declaration, to make that statement, it opens even more walls that we maybe didn't even know were there, and it crushes them beneath the feet of Jesus. Lord Jesus, we come to you today, Lord, your sons and your daughters. We lift our hearts, Lord. We lift them up to you, and we give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor, Lord Jesus. Lord, thank you so much that you have purposed an inheritance and a promise and a plan for each of us, Lord. Thank you that it is your desire to enlarge in our borders, Lord Jesus, to increase our capacity, not only in how we walk out what you have planned for us, Lord, but also in how we receive what you have prepared for us, for our families, for our city, our state, our nation, and our world. Lord Jesus, we ask forgiveness for those times that maybe we've hesitated, or we said, no, not yet. We've let the limits overtake us, Lord. We ask your forgiveness, and Lord, we ask you for the courage to push past those limits, Lord Jesus. And to say, you know, I don't know what it looks like on the other side of these borders. I haven't experienced it before, but Lord, I trust you. I trust you because of who you are. I stand on the promises that you have spoken over my life over and over and over again, even when maybe I didn't even recognize that the promises were there. And Lord Jesus, I thank you. Thank you for putting people around me, Lord, to hold me accountable, to champion, Lord. Thank you that I have that opportunity to do so as well for the people that you've placed around us. And Lord, thank you so much that you supersede anything we could imagine or think, Lord, that what you have planned and what you have prepared is just, it's beyond imagination. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to walk out of these borders. Lord, thank you for the gift of increasing our capacity, Lord, not for us, but Lord Jesus, all for your glory and all for your honor. And Lord Jesus, all for your kingdom, that your name may be glorified above any other. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this time today. And we pray these things in the mighty, beautiful, and victorious name of Jesus Christ. And together, the church said, amen. Amen. Now we'd like to invite our board members, Jim and Susan, to come forward, receive tithes and offerings. And this Wednesday at 6:30, please plan to be back in the house with Pastor Todd and Pastor Susan as they dig even deeper into today's message. Dig deeper into expanding our borders and how that looks for each of us in each of our lives. Thank you.
What a great message. Agree with that, and how exciting that God has this plan to just expand all of our territories and just use us for his kingdom and his glory. On the screen in a minute, it should show all the ways that we can bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord. And you know, in Malachi it talks about bringing, which means everything we have is the Lord's anyway, and so bringing that portion back to him is just helping to further his kingdom while we're here. We're going to read a couple verses in Deuteronomy 26. It says, when you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you as a special possession, and you have conquered it and settled there, put some of the first produce from each crop you harvest into a basket and bring it to the designated place of worship, the place the Lord your God chooses for his name to be honored.
As I read through that, I got to thinking about it a little bit more, and I thought, well, that was a special situation back then. How does that kind of apply to us today? You know, we're all up here for whatever reason that we think we're up here in Alaska. And it just wasn't willy-nilly that we showed up here. There's a verse of scripture over in Proverbs that says, a man's heart plans his ways. We think things out and we think, well, this is what we want to do. It don't stop there. As we proceed in that avenue, he goes on to say, but the Lord will direct his steps. And I started thinking about my own self, how I ended up here. And at first thought, it was a thought to come to Alaska. And for me, I was looking for work. For some of you folks, I'm sure it's military, and that's what got you up here. There's all kinds of reasons that you got here. But there's a higher power at work. But then the Lord directs our steps. And when I go back in life and start reviewing the circumstances that happened along the way, as I came up here a single man and then met my wife and we got married, and circumstances that befell that, I can see where God has been at work. It wasn't just my thinking that prodded me along. They say hindsight's always 20/20. So we're all here today to worship, and we're preparing for an offering. And this is where we came, as God directed, to meet with him. Something to think about as we get ready to bring our tithes and offerings back. The there is a higher power at work in us and directing us, for sure. Praise God for that. Let's pray. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. It is easy to get caught up in the atmosphere and the life that we lead, that sometimes we just don't see you at work. But Lord, you are at work. And Father, make that clear to us as we come, as we worship, as we bring our tithes and offerings back to you. Lord, let us be thankful that you do direct our paths, that you are in charge of our lives, that we can call on you, that there is a higher power and it is you. So much to be thankful for this is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, guys. Jaws. Dun, 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 dun. How did they ever get killed when their music's playing? I remember when that movie came out, I was almost 9 years old, and we went and saw it, and the next summer my dad goes, let's go to the beach. I'm like, I don't want to go to the beach. I saw the movie. I don't want to go to the beach. My dad's like, it's just a movie. Let's go to the beach. So we went to the beach, and I finally got brave enough to go out in the water, and this was on the East Coast, and I'm out there. It's like, I'm going a little deeper, a little deeper, a little deeper. And then all of a sudden, a fin. I'm like, are you kidding me? I think I actually walked on water. And so I go shooting back. I was like, shark, 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 shark. And the lifeguards goes, he's like, it was a nurse shark. I was like, it was a shark. To me, it's a shark. He's like, no, it's a nurse shark. It's only about 4 feet long. This is Satan. He wants you to believe he's the 25-footer waiting to kill you, take you out anytime you want to. When you have Jesus Christ on your side, this is Satan. Later. And that's what you got to believe in your heart. You got to say yes to the man. Jesus Christ is the Savior who makes Satan that little bitty thing right there. In the Bible it says you will be surprised when you see Satan of what he actually looks like when you face him in heaven and he gets his due desserts. And when you stand there and you say, this is who was attacking us, and Jesus will say, yep. That's why I always had your back. Because he is nothing. Don't let him be bigger than what he actually is. Because Satan goes around roaring and gnashing and making you think that he is so big that he's out to take you out every time you turn around. But listen for the music. Dun, 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 dun. Oh, it's Satan. Jesus, you got a visitor. It's time to say yes to Jesus Christ. It's time to extend your borders. It's time to say, Jesus, I love you, and I thank you for the sacrifice that you made for me. And he's always there waiting for you to say yes. And if you make that decision today, we'll have people standing up here and online. Just send us a message, and we'll get with you. Because Jesus is always there. And his music is much better than Satan's. So get in your boat, set sail for the deep end, and expect the unexpected. That's been my life. And when Pastor Teff said that, expect the unexpected, I remember about 11, 12 years ago, me and Amy were going through a situation. It's like, oh God, here we go again. We're la, la, la. And we hear from the back seat, expect the unexpected, Dad. I was like, this little 8-year-old boy says this out of the blue. He has no idea what's going on, but from the mouth of a babe comes, expect the unexpected. And that's the way we got to live. Expect the unexpected, because the unexpected can be the answer to your prayer. So I ask you to rise before we leave here. We're going to send out in an awesome worship song, right? Love you guys. Have a blessed day. And don't forget pizza with the pastors if you're new to the church. We love you guys. Have a blessed day.